Okay, all right. So we are in a Daniel class number 9, and we only have 2 more classes left after this. It makes me very sad because the Lord has been so precious to us, and he will continue. It's the living, eternal word. It's the Logos, and it's not just, well, I pray it's not just teaching, and I know it's not for us, so let's pray. I have been waiting to teach this class, today's class, for probably 2 or 3 years. And I keep wanting to teach it, and the Holy Spirit keeps, you know, taking steps of preparation beforehand. I think today we may actually teach this class, not teach it, but share it, because I need this class so very deeply. And an hour before class, the wonderful Holy Spirit just gave me just his heart in a deeper, I want to say deeper in a teaching way, but in a greater embrace of the spiritual inward dealing that this chapter deals with. So having just received that, I am wonderfully insufficient to share it, which puts all of my confidence on the Holy Spirit to share it, which is always great and much better than the strongest and best of us. So let's pray for him to release the things of his heart today in this class. And for us to be, as we are, prepared of the Spirit to receive them. So, Lord, we just thank you for your heart. Thank you that you are such a wonderful Father. You know us intimately. Lord, you don't look upon us as students and philosophers and people who need great depths of teaching and understanding of apocalyptic prophetic events to get more spiritual. You see us as your family who need in very real ways for Jesus to live and govern and be who he is in us. And you father our spirits and you guide us in the process, stage by stage, part by part, until that Lamb has taken his throne as our life and the governing nature within. Lord, it's not always pretty, the path. It's not always easy, but you're there every step of the way. You are our Father, Holy Spirit. You are the one who's working deep inside of us for this Lamb to be enthroned. And Lamb of God, you are the one who is the life. You fulfill it all inside of us just by being who you are. Lord, thank you that so much that is in the Word of God, so much of the bulk of the Bible, is given to this time period of knowing you in this place of deep inward dealing that brings forth the bride, the Jerusalem of your heart. So, Father, give utterance today, maybe not even in word, but in the spirit that is released into our hearts. Give understanding and eyes to see and hearts to be good ground, so these seeds can go in and come forth in their time by you. We just open ourselves to you today and thank you for loving us so graciously. We love you too, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I am going to begin just with where we left off. If we have time at the end of the class, we're gonna share some things about our chart, because the Lord has been moving in you guys and sharing and helping to make it more exact and more specifically on target with the dates and the seasons of dealing and all that. So I'm very blessed. I'm very blessed with that response from your hearts, and I would like to discuss it further. But let's just jump in to the things that are in the Word for us today. Last class, we talked about the preparations of our heart for today's discussion. And I encouraged everybody, and I felt it was the Lord encouraging us to not let teaching rob us of the wonder of our own eyes beholding the King in his glory and the things the Word of God is so graciously imparting to us as the Holy Spirit unveils the Lord within these words. And so I hope you all had really intimate times and continue to with the Lord in seeking him, eternal life in these verses, and I know you will, and I know I will. I want to. I need to. Let's begin in Daniel chapter 7. Finally, and if we do refer to our chart, Daniel chapter 7 is the first time we've moved out of the dealing that has to do with teaching and preparation, and all of that was under the time of Nebuchadnezzar. And we had chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, and chapter 4 all as part of teaching and preparation. So chapter 7 is the first time that we actually step across the bridge or on the bridge or into the realm, as we so sillily, as we so much described last class. We finally enter into the realm of the inward dealing, the circumcision of the heart, and how precious to be here, because now the things we were learning and the things that our heart was being prepared for, God's able to get some entrance on the inside, and that's what we want. We want it not to just stay up in our head, but get down into our heart. And so how wonderful that we're changing seasons in these verses. But in God's sweetness, he prepared us for this so we wouldn't get attacked by all the fears and things that try to grab us when we start moving into this realm of dealing. So we could actually glean the fatness of this thing. Do you know what I'm saying? Get it all. Hallelujah. Okay, so let's look at chapter 7. It's beautiful how the Word of God just defines these things. Chapter 7 and verse 1. So the first sentence is perfect. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon. So we have now left the Nebuchadnezzar years, and we're in the very first year of Belshazzar. And immediately upon that first year, the spirit starts moving differently. How cool is that? He's moving. Have you ever felt the spirit start moving differently in your life? You know, like he's challenging you. Let's go further. Let's get out of that season of wandering. Let's jump into entering in, or let's get out of that season of just being taught things, and let's let the word become a two-edged sword and begin to get inside, you know, and you feel the difference, don't you? It's almost like there's a new covering that's bringing a new flow. And that, of course, our king is King Jesus and God our Father. But you feel that change up above flowing down. And, of course, that's God, God, the living God, who we are one with in his dealings with us to conform us to the image of his son, to form his son in us. So it's the first year of the inward dealings. We can just say that. In the first year of my inward dealing and circumcision of the heart, I had dreams. Oops. I want Nebuchadnezzar to have the dream. Why do I have to have the dream? No. He was the one who was disturbed all night. He's the one, Nebuchadnezzar, remember in chapter 2, it was his heart that was pounding all night long, going, what the heck does this mean? Remember how freaked out Nebuchadnezzar was? It was not pretty when he had a dream. He's just like ready to behead anyone who couldn't tell him what it meant. And, you know, he was well on his way to do so. So it was a disturbing thing for Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel, it was disturbing to Daniel because he was going to be killed if he didn't interpret it in everyone else. But it wasn't his dream. It was Nebuchadnezzar's dream. So you kind of have that, well, it's Nebuchadnezzar who's got issues. I'm just the spiritual Hebrew that prays and get answers. And because I prayed and got answers, that means I'm better than Nebuchadnezzar because God used me. And the Lord's like, just keep learning, son. Just keep being prepared because I have dreams and visions for your head upon your bed. That will come when it's the time for you, my little one, to grow up, you know, and it's cool, isn't it? You see the Lord's care in that. So all of a sudden, Nebuchadnezzar's dead and all his dreams, and along with him, the wonderful, incredible demonstration of how we should not be. With him dies our great example of golden statues and beasts for 7 years eating grass and growing hair and claws. Using power to manipulate and control everyone by fear, and being the most beautiful God-given gift of a demonstration of what the other kingdom looks like. Thank you, God, for Nebuchadnezzar. Thank you, God, for Pharaoh. Thank you, God, for wonderful examples of what you don't look like and what we could look like if we continue, you know. But I'm saying it is a great the great teaching, the great object lesson, the great man who showed us so many things is dead. Why? Well, in Joshua chapter 1, I remember when the scripture said, well, guess what? Moses is dead, and Joshua, it's your turn to enter in. You know, now, I am in no wise connecting Moses and Nebuchadnezzar. No. But I'm saying in a very far away view that one was removed so another could enter in deeper. And sometimes God removes those outward teachers that he used so powerfully, which could be that boss at work. Teachers. I'm not talking spiritual knowledge teachers. I'm talking the teachers that teach you government. The teachers that show you government and what it looks like. And you learn a lot from how they abuse you, how they misuse you, how they deal with things, how they manifest another mind, another spirit, another nature. And wow, what we learned through Nebuchadnezzar. And then at the very end, God dealt with him. Praise God. Tremendous. He dies. And so does that wonderful season of our deep spiritual walk that wasn't as spiritual as we thought it was, praise Jesus, but we were still one with Jesus in it. Nothing changes that. Nothing takes that away. We just want more government, more forming of that sun within. So he dies. The seasons change. And Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dreams and told the sum of the matters. Okay, so significant that Daniel is now the one being dealt with. So significant. Beyond my words. Verse 2, Daniel spoke and said, I saw in my vision by night, and I think that it's important to notice he said by night. The Spirit of God really enlightened that by night thing. You know, there's certain kind of visions you might say. It was like the sun was shining, and I saw the Lamb of God, you know, leaping through, you know. I was butterflies and, you know, sunshine and rainbows, and I'm a Christian hippie with visions in the day. You know, I don't know, but it's not one of those visions. You know, it's one of those that come at night, and when you just go, this is dark, and what can I say? You know what I mean. Have you ever heard of St. John of the Cross as the dark night of the soul? Yeah. You know, kind of like that, you know. This is the dark night of the soul. This is the dealing, the deeper inward thing. So he writes them down. So he's, you know, I don't know how Holy Spirit to not go beyond this wonderful moment here in the scripture till we can drink in the fullness of what could get in our hearts from it. So Daniel got that dream, and instead of going, that was a bad nightmare, let's forget it. Lord, erase it from my memory. I bind you, Satan, in the name of Jesus. You know, because it's easy to deal with stuff like that, isn't it? You just kind of go, well, and there's a place for that. My Lord, amen. And there is a time for it, of course. But as we listen to the full context of what God is sharing in these verses, we'll bring this example into that instead of misusing it in other ways. But when this dealing was upon him coming down from the head, his head, Jesus, instead of dismissing it, he wrote it down. You see that in verse 2? He wrote it down. That wasn't easy. That wasn't easy. Mm-mm. And as he writes it down, we begin to see key elements for all of us in our journey during this season that are tremendous. Praise God. There are keys that can turn those locked doors in your heart and just open it up to the Lord in this season. I feel that even the things he just shared before class, it's like there are keys that can just go like this. It's the word of God. But they're like keys that can go like this and just open up chambers that would stay locked with fear and trepidation because of the darkness of this night and open us up to the glorious things God is doing within these not so glorious times. So let's close and go back and be with the Spirit over it, and prayerfully so. So here we go in what he wrote down, because these are part of those keys, so listen close. Verse 2 of chapter 7, Daniel spoke, and I said, I saw in my visions by night, I saw this. Behold, the four winds of heaven strove upon the great sea. Stop there, because that's important. Okay, so we have the four winds of heaven. I have meditated on this for so long. I believe that, to me, you have to ask the Lord for yourself. This is my opinion. But I believe those four winds, they come from heaven. Note that, because it doesn't say they came from the earth or from under the earth or from demons, or they came from heaven. And they strove upon the sea. So I see in those four winds the Spirit of God from heaven moving in a new way upon the sea of humanity. And in many scriptures, the sea equals humanity, the mass of humanity, just the multiple, just many, 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 many nations, peoples, the sea of humanity. You can search that out and see if it be so. But I believe that that's the case here, that the Spirit of God has been sent down during the season of inward dealing, and he begins to move like a winds among the great sea. And he is, I believe, and I have it written down, and I didn't, let me just turn to the page where my personal notes are written in this. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is striving with all flesh to conform to the Lamb. He's striving. I feel like he's using circumstances, but he is dealing within that storm, within that blowing wind, to get something that will conform to the image of Christ, where Christ can be brought forth. That all things work together to good to those who are called according to the purpose of God, who love him, to be conformed to the image of his Son. So he's striving with all nations and all humanity with the purpose of bringing forth Christ in them. Is that not the purpose for which the Spirit was sent? Yeah, yeah. But he's not teaching them. He's striving. Does it not even say the word strive? I bet it does. The Holy Spirit is striving with all flesh. Maybe that the four winds of heaven strove. It does say strove. Praise God. So he's striving. He's striving, and he's blowing, and he's stirring it up, trying to bring forth reactions. Reactions. Now, when that wind's blowing like that and stirring it up, if you will, striving, it's usually not just a teaching that does that. You know, we can sit there through a teachings like we did with Nebuchadnezzar, and go, amen, I see that, I agree, I'll share that with Nebuchadnezzar and have this wisdom for everyone to be awed by, or this great knowledge or whatnot. Knowledge would be the better word, knowledge and God-given answers and things, and that comes from teaching, comes from the Spirit preparing us, but it doesn't come from this inward striving. So now the Spirit's coming, and he's probably within that sea of humanity, as he's blowing in that manner, things are being blown about in the water. Things at work that affect things in your mind, things in the family that affect things in your soul, things going on in the world, things going on in your world, things going on that affect things going on within you. And he keeps blowing and blowing, and these four winds keep moving on this mass of humanity to bring forth the Son. And what happens? What do the scriptures say happen? Remember, this is the dream of the beginning of this inward dealing. Four great beasts come up from the sea. I would like you to notice this is Daniel's dream, not Nebuchadnezzar's dream. Daniel is of the people of God and beloved of the Lord. He's not rejected. He's not a failure. He's not condemned. He is under the almighty caring love of God, his Father, to bring forth Christ and to enthrone the Lamb. And this is part of the process. This is part of Daniel's God-ordained ancient path journey that everyone has to take. It is not someone backsliding. It is not someone failing. It is someone entering in and taking their step in due season. Be encouraged. Amen. Have to have that when you enter into this area. We talked about that last week. four great beasts rise in Daniel's dream on his bed. From where? The sea. And now the sea can be that mass of humanity being dealt with by the Spirit of God to bring forth the Son. But it's also the deep places within us. I just feel that. You need to search that out. I'm not asking you to believe it because I think it. I'm asking you to consider it before the Lord and search it out in the Scripture. God, please don't believe me. The Word of God, the Spirit of God, and I'm just asking you to consider. But I think that at this point also that sea is the deep inward parts of us, because even in Genesis we see the Spirit brooding over the waters in the dark and unformed places to bring forth the Son. You know, and you kind of feel like that's the earthen vessel, that earth that it's speaking of in Genesis is the earth of us, earthen vessels with Christ within. So he's like striving with our hearts. He's striving with everybody, but he's striving with me. And he's striving with me to bring something of Christ deep inside of me, not just a teaching in my head. And as that striving happens, something starts rising. And guess what? It's not the Son. This is Daniel's dream. All of a sudden, these beasts start rising out from deep within. And they're terrifying. They're terrifying. I mean, my goodness, look at the first was like a lion. It had eagle's wings. I beheld till its wings were plucked and it was lifted from its earth. On and on. The second was a bear. I'm not going to read everything. The third was a leopard. And the fourth beast was dreadful and terrible and exceedingly strong with iron teeth. It devours and breaks in pieces. It stamps. It has 10 horns. So he's, yeah, go ahead, Noah.
The Lord was kind of placed into my heart as I was reading that was the more the Spirit is stirring within our hearts, oftentimes we'll be like, oh, the beasts will get better, you know, as they're coming out, but they're getting worse. Like, you know, like the deeper the Spirit goes within us, the greater the beast that will arise because, you know, we're being more transformed. The real us starts to pop out, the real beast pops out. And so, anyway, that's just what I was thinking as you get to the last, you know, beast. It's like, this is the worst of all, you know.
Yeah, it's so encouraging. I mean, to my heart, because it's like he's going in there to get the dross up and out. Because our true identity is Christ. We're in the Son. The Son is in us. But this is about forming that Son that's in there, getting out stuff that shouldn't be. It's been removed by the cross, but it hasn't been skimmed off and brought up to the surface and skimmed off yet. Oh, I love that. So the more the Spirit deals with us, the more he's able to go into joint and marrow and motive and intent and separate soul from spirit. And he starts showing us what's really in the temple. And if you look in Ezekiel chapters 8 and 9, you can read some of the things that are in the temple right before the exile happened, before the captivity happened, creeping things, idolatry, horrible, horrible things of imagery and just defiling things hidden deep inside the temple. Ezekiel's chapter 8 and 9 declare this. But we are the temple of the Lord. And in the temple there is a holy of holies where the Lamb is enthroned and out from whence comes life. Well, for that Lamb to have his proper place, you got to get the throne room ready. You know, So the Word goes in there and he starts not just for us to receive the dealing. He's not just preparing us to receive the dealing. He's preparing the king to get his throne. You know, before, we just need preparation so we don't freak out and run away screaming. We just need all the preparation in the world so we can at least stay on the bridge and cross over. You know, that's a victory. It's a huge deal. But it's only the beginning, because once we're ready to go into the first year of inward dealing, when Nebuchadnezzar dies and Belshazzar takes the headship, we are confronted with a whole new dealing. And that's the Spirit now going in and saying, let's do a deep sea dive into your inward parts and see if the Lamb is on the throne or not. And you go, but that means I'm not in Christ. No, he already told you are. He already told you. You are dead. Your life is hid with Christ in God. You're complete in him. You're seated in heavenly places. It is finished. Hallelujah. Amen. Yes. But what isn't finished is the inward work of that possessing our inward parts. It's all true, but we are still being made conformable to his image as we grow in the knowledge of him in whom we are. And it's not that we're earning something, it's that we're being awakened to what is. And as we are awakened and as we receive the truth as it is in Jesus, it brings it forth in us in greater measure to be manifested. And so we understand that more from being dealt with to prepare us for this. So once the Holy Spirit does the deep sea dive and he starts, you know, bringing the dross to the surface, the beasts start to rise. Okay, what could be the rising of a beast? I'm sure we all have many. You know, it's the wind is blowing and it blows upon Joe, my supervisor at work. And it blows upon me, and a beast comes out to Joe, the supervisor, and it bites his head off. And the wind keeps blowing, and an exceedingly terrible one stomps him to the ground. And, you know, like Noah was saying, and we're going, and it's very akin to Romans chapter 7, the New Testament version of this, which Daniel is passing through in his Old Testament picture, is just like, I love you, Lord. I know that I'm yours. My heart longs after you. I rejoice in the word of God. I rejoice in the things of your heart. But when the wind blows and the sea churns, a beast rises. Oh, wretched man that I am. I mean, just go, what is that reaction rising from the sea, coming up from deep within me? And it's bad, isn't it? It's horrifying. Now, to me, this is that point where many Christians go, if anybody knew what was coming out of me right now after I'm saved, they would think I wasn't saved. So what I'm going to do, not knowing that even Daniel went through this, the Apostle Paul went through this, everyone who's had Christ formed in them went through this. It's no big secret. You're not the only one. Everyone goes through this that continues to know the Lord. But you think you're the only one, and you think your beasts are worse than all other beasts before you, and you feel that you have failed God and his eternal plan, and you need to quit the church, the Bible school, maybe even drop out of Christianity, which, whatever, but don't leave Jesus. And so anyway, and you're just like, I can't tell anyone, what am I going to do? And you go, I have got it. I'm going to be a fakey Christian for the rest of my miserable life, for the rest of my miserable existence on this planet. I am gonna fake Jesus in the midst of my beasts who continuously rise from the sea. Because if anybody knew, the shame would be too great. I think the Lord understands. I think if we were all honest, every single one of us would raise our hand and say, guilty as charged to some degree or another. I do that, and I have done that, and I probably still will until the Lord just helps me. Because it's so easy to take those fig leaves and just run for it. Run for the hills, man. It's terrifying. I mean, these guys are no wonder Daniel. Let's look at verse 15 in chapter 7. Gives a little more insight into how Daniel was feeling that night on his bed. I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit in the midst of my body. There it is. There's that sea. In the midst of my body. And the visions of my head troubled me. I mean, there's a point when this keeps going on. He literally gets sick. Yeah. He just gets sick. He just gets sick to his stomach. He's astonished. It just terrifies. I mean, it's a big deal, isn't it, to let the Lord do his work and to respond real, but real. We're going to talk about the but real here in a moment. Real, but real. Real is our friend. Fake is our enemy. Faking it puts us in a little cage where the devil comes to beat us up. And the devil says, that's Jesus who's mad at you. It's not Jesus who's mad at you. Jesus is drawing you in. Jesus is coming to bring forth his son in you. The devil's saying, you're the only one who has those beasts, and you should pretend to not have them and hide yourself away deep inside with your dark secret. it's not fun to carry a dark secret around called who I really am, especially when it's a lie, especially when those beasts have been crucified and put away, and the Lord's just getting dross out. But he needs us to be real with him so he can do this wonderful inward dealing of bringing forth his son. It's a great thing. So, but even Daniel struggled. Take heart from that. Even Daniel struggled. Even Paul struggled. So who are we to not struggle? We're going to struggle. It's okay. It's okay. Praise God. Okay, let's keep going. So we have these beasts. They keep getting worse. Our reactions, instead of, like Noah said, which I just loved that comment, instead of getting better, we somehow seem to get worse. And somehow the dagum Holy Spirit, who is our best friend, keeps blowing on the water. We're like, come on, just blow on the word. Quit blowing on the water of me. You know, I just need to feel spiritual again. What do I have to do for you to take me back to making me feel spiritual when I'm not? Because I love the feel of that. And this is awful. I don't think I'm going to live through this. And you're like, good. That's a good thing. You know, it's a good thing. So, you know, this is no easy thing, but the Lord is so good. So he's going on. He says, Lord, let's keep going. Let's do this. I don't want to wander 40 years and be confronted with these beasts again. Let's do it. So verse 8 says that Daniel considered the horns. All right, stop there because I loved that verse and the Lord really moved on that verse. I considered the horns. So before, when Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, we considered Nebuchadnezzar's horns. Look at that pushy thing rising up out of him. Look at that strong opinion that he just pushes on everybody else. Look at his rebellion against God. He stands up as his leader, stands up as his own rebellious authority without submitting to being under God's authority. You know, these horns rise, these horns of pride and rebellion and false authority. You know what I mean? Outside of God's authority. Well, we've considered Nebuchadnezzar's horns for 45 years or 30 years in Babylon. God's saying, I want you to consider your horns. That's, you know, how do I consider the horns without going into depression or condemnation? Well, let's see. Daniel considered the horns and pondered the way of man as opposed to the way of the Lamb. Oh, I had notes on this that were much better, but I don't, but Lord, notes are nothing. Let's just talk from our hearts. When we're challenged with an unjust situation or a pushy guy at work or someone who's really abusing or, you know, that situation that's like pushing us and pulling and drawing out reactions, something rises from us. And a lot of times it's like pride goes, pushes itself forward like a horn. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Out of the beast. And it says, I'm better than you think. You don't know how good I am. As the beast is rising. Wow, we're special, aren't we? We have a special ability to justify flesh, even when it's beast flesh with horns. We all have it. It's part of the sickness that we were born with until Christ be formed. So he said, I'm going to consider that horn. What is it that comes out of me, who is the temple of the Lord and is meant to have Jesus come out of me, when I'm treated that way? What reaction rises from my midst that is like Nebuchadnezzar was in contrast with the three Hebrews in the furnace? What is that in me that is so other than that slaughtered lamb, the one on the throne, in his weakness, in his self-giving love, in his meekness, amen, in the way he responds when spit upon, when mocked, when blasphemed, when treated as the refuse of the world, when he's the Son of God? What rises in the Lamb when he's confronted with these very same winds, as opposed to what's coming out of me under the same things, even much less? And the consideration of that is not considering it to go, I'm identified with it. This is not the consideration of identification. We must remain identified in Christ through this whole dealing. This is the consideration of going, Lord, look at the contrast of how you respond as to what the flesh does in this situation. And we allow soul to be divided from spirit. We allow the word of God to go, that's who you used to be. That's what was crucified. That's the old creation. That's you apart from me. But consider not just your horns, but the Lamb. Consider the one who is your life now and how he responds. And you're not looking inwardly in this consideration. You're looking Lamb-wardly. You're looking at the division of governments. It's a beautiful thing. It's an awful thing, but it's a beautiful thing because you're beginning to take things that were all gray and fuzzy, and they're becoming black and white, hot and cold, one kingdom and another kingdom, and you're seeing things more for what they are. You're also seeing what the cross did more clearly, and it's dividing out. That's Christ in you, but that's the old. That has been removed, and we just want to skim that off, get that out, what the cross already did. The circumcision of the heart, amen? Yeah, so you're considering it, and then you're beholding the Lamb, and you're going, this is what I am apart from Jesus. This is why I need to let the Spirit deal with me deep inside. But your eyes acknowledge that they're real, but real. Real, but real means I'm real about that area, and I'm considering these ruts that I've always just let effortlessly rise and flow out of me. And now I'm considering him who is my life. And I'm beholding the Lamb and his reactions, his nature, his mind, his government, his inward parts, his spirit. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, really, it is, because in the scriptures, in this verse, I think it's, what is it, 8 or 9? 8. He said, I consider the horns and behold, and it goes on to describe some things, but if you look at verse 9, that's really where I want to focus the beholding. I beheld until, this is part of what the Lord shared with me a couple hours before class. I beheld until the thrones were placed and the Ancient of Days did sit. I beheld until him whose garment was white as snow and the hair of his head as pure wool, until his throne was like the fiery flame and his wheels like burning fire. I beheld until a fiery stream issued and came forth from him, and 1,000 thousands ministered unto him. 10,000s times 10,000 stood before him. I beheld because the voice of the great words which the horn spoke. I beheld even until the beast was slain and its body was destroyed and given to the burning flame. Isn't that beautiful that this person beheld until the Lamb filled not just his teaching, not just his eyes, but began to be a possessing of those parts where that beast, he's letting that process. And I'm trying to define what I felt the Spirit shared with me today, and we're going to look in the scriptures and in two other places. But this sea, this is the sea down here. Gosh, I know people can't see it very much. And this is the heavens, okay? This is the sea in us, and this is the heavens. And the Spirit's striving, you know, he's striving upon things to bring up what's in us out of us, okay? And things start rising. And as they rise, they're ugly, really ugly, exceedingly ugly, get worse instead of get better at first. But it's right here when things rise that the heart does something tremendous, that Daniel's heart did something, and our hearts can too. It began to acknowledge what we are apart from Christ in reactions, in the ways we respond. But immediately it started lifting up its gaze to the one who is its true king, its true government, its true life, because of the cross, because of the cross, because of the cross. This is who we are, this enthroned Lamb, and this is the government we are of. Jesus said to his disciples, you don't know what spirit you're of. because they were acting like beasts. I want to sit on your right hand and your left. I want to be more important than everyone else. I want to have power and pride. And, you know, they were acting like a whole different kind of creature than the lamb. James and John, even John. But Jesus said, you're mine. You just don't know what the spirit of this kingdom's like. You're part of me. I am the true king, and you're part of me. But you don't know the spirit you're of. And that's part of what this is doing. We're of that. We haven't entered in to the fullness of it. It hasn't gotten the reins of our heart yet as he's formed. So right here, right here, right here, this is key. And let me tell you, it's no easy thing when you get to that place where the beasts are rising to stop and acknowledge it and not cover it up, but not go into depression and condemnation, but immediately turn your gaze up to the slain lamb who is your life and keep beholding until he is enthroned. How amazing is this? Listen to the things it was said one more time. I beheld till the Ancient of Days did sit. I beheld till the thrones were replaced and cast down. It says that word replaced in my King James means I beheld till the thrones were cast down. I didn't cast down the thrones to make them go away. I just kept identifying and beholding the Lamb of God until these things fell, like Jericho. They just fell. Because I was so busy looking at the Lamb and identifying with him that I kept looking until these beasts and their thrones fell in the presence of the true King, the Lamb of God. Isn't that beautiful? Go ahead.
And just when I was reading these scriptures this morning, I was thinking, like, a lot of us have been journaling about, like, specific areas, and the Lord's been bringing specific areas, and it just really felt like the Spirit was pointing at those horns, just like you were saying, and saying, that's what it is. You know, whatever your area is, it's one of those horns. And it might be that particularly talkative horn that blasphemes right to the face of the Ancient of Days, right? Because it talks, that little one, right? It talks. But I was just like, when you look at it like that, and I love that Daniel calls him the Ancient of Days. He is drawing comparison. Like, that little problem might be blaspheming right to the face of the Ancient of Days, like he can't deal with it. But it's a little horn, and he is the Ancient of Days. There is no contest in this scenario. And the other thing the Spirit pointed out was, Daniel never got a handle on what the form of that brute beast, you know what I mean? That brute beast that the horns are popping out of. He couldn't tell you what it looked like. He couldn't tell you what kind of animal it was, like the other ones.
The exceedingly dreadful.
Yeah, and you know what? He didn't have to. He didn't have to figure it out. He just had to keep it holding until it was slain.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
Holding the lamb.
He did not have to figure out the ins and out of this god-awful root of these horrible horns that are popping up.
Right.
He didn't have to analyze it until he understood its form and figured out what animal he could compare it to and whatever. It was terrible, and it was the root of these things, but he just had to keep beholding until he saw it slain, until he saw the judgment come to it.
That's right. I like that you said that, because
the beholding that he was doing was to keep beholding the Lamb. Now, we know that exceedingly dreadful beast and all of them and all of the old creation was crucified in Christ, and we were taught that in the first season. We all know that thing is dead. It's crucified. It was dealt with at the cross, and it's buried. So the beholding now is just to acknowledge that, oh, that still rises. It's dead. It's dealt with. But I'm going to keep looking at the Lamb until now that thing doesn't rise anymore because Christ has taken the throne. Do you see what I'm saying? It's a different beholding. I'm beholding not until it's dead, because it's already dead. I am beholding until its throne is cast down and the real king is motivating my heart. See, it's different. It's already dead. It's already... Yeah, it's not enough for me to look at the Bible and read in Romans chapter 6, I am dead, when the beast is still rising. So I need to behold the Lamb until what's true in chapter 6 is manifested in chapter 8 of Romans. See that? So you have to keep beholding the Lamb until those things that are dead no longer have a place in me to govern. Are they dead? Yes, Romans 6 says that. But Romans 7 says there's still a problem. That's the Bible, lads. Romans 6 says they're dead. Romans 6 says they're buried. Romans 6 said they're gone. Romans 7 says there's something still rising from the sea. And something turned in the heart of Paul that by Romans 8 brought him into a whole new realm of liberty based on something in the spirit having preeminence over the things of the flesh within him. And that's the work of the spirit to make Romans 6 real. And that's what someone who's getting dealt with inwardly is confronted with. Doctrinally, yeah, it's dealt with. Spiritually, yeah, it's dealt with. In our walk, we have to behold until it has captivated us and it has smitten those kingdoms like that rock did in the first dream of Nebuchadnezzar and knocked them down. Well, that's what it says. There's so much in this book, guys. We'd need years, honestly. Because, right, let's look at chapter 7. There's so much here. Let's start at verse 15. Daniel was grieved in my spirit in the midst of my body. The visions of my head troubled me. I came near unto one of them that stood by and asked him the truth of all this. So he told me and made me know the interpretation of the things. These great beasts, which are four kings who rise out of the earth. See, these things aren't just the old creation that's dead, the body of sin. These are kings. These are things that govern our reactions. Amen. We all know the difference deep, deep down inside. That's what's being dealt with, is our government. The finished work of the cross isn't being dealt with here. The government, until the Lamb has been enthroned, Christ has been formed. He must increase, but I must decrease. These are the issues, right? Okay, so, but that wasn't even the point. Verse 18 is the point. But, these great, let's 17, these great beasts, which are four, are kings. Kings that rise out of our earth. But the saints of the Most High, of who? Shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Verse 21, I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints. What does that sound like? Book of Revelation. And what? Prevailed against them. We will never defeat these beasts in our own strength, but in slain lamb. Until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. And the time came and the saints possessed. The time came and the saints possessed the kingdom. It just continues to go on. But we need to go to Ezekiel chapter 1. Okay, just turn there, and I'm going to, for sake of time, like I said, you need to keep going on in Daniel in your own time, because there is so much the Holy Spirit has for you beyond what I have time to share, and it's not my place to share it. It's for you and the Lord. Okay, so we get to this point here where we've got this dream in the night, the spirit stirring, and all these things that lurk in the night and in the deep depths come up. Wow, these are reactions now coming out of us in the earth. They're bestial, they're powerful, they're not land. If we were really, really honest, we would say it like this. They're anti-lamb. What do these things that are in us, what are they? We don't like to hear this, but we need to be real, because then the Lord can skim that. The contrast can be stronger. These reactions and things that we might want to minimize, war against the lamb. They do. They war against. The carnal mind is at war. That's what Paul said, at war with God. These things war against the lamb. They are so contrary to his ways and his kingdom. And when we realize, my gosh, that thing that's rising up out of me, that reaction that I used to call just whatever, my personality disorder, that thing's warring against the Lamb, and it's warring against the Lamb taking his throne in me. And it does something to us. It does something if we're ready to not be condemned and get on with it in love. We're ready to behold the Lamb till that thing's cast down and no longer rising, that the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus makes us free from the governing influence of things that have been crucified but still remoting us, fighting us deep within. Amen? So we start beholding the Lamb. We start letting the heart turn towards the Lord, like 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, 19 say. And we, you know, as the heart turns towards the Lord, the veil is rent. We be in the power of the Spirit as we behold Him. We're being changed into that same image from glory to glory. There's something's happening when that heart starts turning towards the Lord and beholding the Lamb with that faith, I am one with Him. And these beasts are cast down, but they rise in a new form. They rise in a new form. It's incredible. The very same time period when Daniel was having this vision, Ezekiel, who's in Babylon, his next door neighbors, the guy's the same age. He's having a vision at the River Chebar of four beasts too. Coincidence? In the Word of God? I don't think so. Let's read about these four beasts. Okay, Ezekiel chapter 1. Now it came to pass in the 13th year, in the fourth month, in the fifth day of the month. I'd like to know exactly when that is compared to the first year of Belshazzar, if anyone's interested. I am. In the fifth day of the month, this is obviously a very momentous occasion. All right. Oh, it's in the fifth year of King Jehoiakim's captivity. Oh, this is early on. So this is something to give encouragement, even early before these things happen. The word of the Lord came expressly unto Ezekiel the priest. Okay, verse 4. And I looked, and behold, a whirlwind, wind blowing, came out of the north. We saw those winds in Daniel's dream, didn't we? A great cloud and a fire enfolded itself, and a brightness was about it. And out of the midst of this whirlwind, these whirling winds, out of the midst of that, like the color of amber, out of the midst of it, like the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire, out of the midst of that came the likeness of four living creatures. These living creatures are also appearing in chapter 4 and 5 of Revelation, and they're called beasts there in some translations. These four living creatures, their appearance they had was like a man. There's four of them, just like we had four beasts rising from the sea in Daniel's dream. Each four had four faces, four wings. Oh, there's so much in this vision, but all of it is really beautiful. Their feet were straight feet. Let me continue in verse 9 here. Their wings were joined one to another. They turned not when they went. Everyone went straight forward. Verse 11, their wings were joined together. Verse 12, they went everyone straight forward. Wherever the Spirit was to go, they went. They did not turn, but they went. Verse 13, the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like burning coals of fire, like the appearance of lamps. Do you remember some things we just read in Daniel's dream about fire and wheels and fiery streams coming from the throne? Here's those fiery streams. It went up and down. Let's just go. Among the living, let's go read that verse. Who can find it? Who can find that verse in Daniel? Guess what book comes right after Ezekiel? Who can guess? Uh-huh. Okay, so we're scripture searchers today, guys. We're just searching. Okay. Chapter 7, verse 9. I beheld till the thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame. His wheels were like burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from him. Okay, let's go back to Ezekiel chapter 1. Verse 13. The likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like burning coals of fire. Woo! We're talking throne, enthroned realm. Like the appearance of lamp, these guys have done some massive beholding. They have arisen up from the sea of self responses until they were not just delivered from the body of the beast that was slain and consumed, but lifted up into the very throne of the Lamb and changed into that same image. It went up and down among the living creatures. The fire was bright. Out of the fire went forth lightning. The living creatures ran and returned like the appearance of a flash of lightning. Now as I beheld the living creatures, behold, one wheel upon the earth by the living creatures with four faces, the appearance of the wheel and their work was like the color of beryl, the forehead one likeness. It was like a wheel in the middle of a wheel. I'm just touching spots here in the verses. Verse 17, when they went upon four sides. They turned not where they went. As for their rims, the rims of these wheels, they were so high that they were dreadful, and they were full of eyes, carried by wheels full of eyes. Where do you think all those eyes came from? Where do you think all those eyes came from? We're talking four exceedingly dreadful beasts rising from the sea, and now we're talking four beasts that are now living creatures that are full of eyes, carrying the throne of God, full of eyes. Don't look at yourself. Look at the Lamb. Behold until we are changed. This is such great stuff. He is prophesying this to the people who are captives in Babylon because they missed it. They just blew the chili. And they're in Babylon, the glory and the presence of God lifted from the temple in chapter 10 of Ezekiel and just took off. But in chapter 1, God shows his heart and the end from the beginning, and he says, look at what can happen to you if you behold and identify and with eyes filled with my glory, drink it in and be of and commune and feast and worship and fellowship. Oh, hallelujah. It's so good, guys. It's so good. These creatures are so similar, but one's with the Lamb and the other's coming out of us before that enthronement. And only thing separating them is eyes that say, I won't look at myself, I'll look at the Lamb. I won't justify it, but I'll let it work contrast in me so that I can just fill my gaze with the King and his kingdom, with his motives and intents, with the nature that fills that throne with true glory and wants to fill the throne room of my heart, who is the true temple. We are that temple. Our hearts are that throne. Amen. Oh my God, it's so good, guys. It's so good. It's just good. Oh, praise the Lord. Verse 19, and when the living creatures went, the wheels went by them. And when the living creatures were lifted from the earth, the wheels were lifted up. Wherever the spirit was to go, they went. There was the spirit to go, the wheels were lifted up. When they rose, these went. When they stood, these stood. When these were lifted up from the earth, the wheels were lifted up from the earth. The likeness of the firmament upon the heads of the living creatures was the color of terrible crystal stretched forth over their heads. I'm sure y'all are familiar with these. Under the firmament of their wings, straight one towards the other, every one had two, which covered on this side and the other and covered their bodies. I heard their wings like the noise of great waters. Verse 26 is important. And above the firmament that was over their head was the likeness of a throne. Oh my gosh. These guys have beheld so much that they are literally carrying the throne of God everywhere they go, and they go everywhere they go because of oneness with the spirit of the thing. I mean, that's where beholding will get you. Amen. I don't see the temple down here because Jerusalem is being, you know, ransacked and destroyed. I don't see the temple in me because beasts are rising from the sea. I do see the Lamb, but we would see Jesus, fixing our eyes on Jesus, looking unto Jesus. But I see him who is my life. I see him beyond just someone far away. I see into him because the Holy Spirit is opening my eyes to see things that my eyes can't see. He's giving me the Spirit's view into him who is the King of kings and Lord of lords, him who is my life. And I am being changed into that same image because I'm not going to break gaze. I'm not going to stop identifying. I'm not going to stop seeking and beholding in this heart that's turning towards the Lord, and a veil is being rent over me, and I'm seeing him, and it's the Spirit showing it, and it's changing me into his image. His life is being formed. And you just keep beholding until the thrones are cast down. You keep beholding until the body of the beast is destroyed. You keep beholding until its body is given to fire. You keep beholding until the Ancient of Days does sit. You keep beholding till the fire of that altar that is in the very bosom of the Lamb starts filling your being with that same crucified nature. You keep beholding until it starts moving you. You keep beholding until everywhere you go, it goes. You keep beholding until you're carrying the throne everywhere you go. My God. Hallelujah. And then here's the next thing. So you got these four beasts. I don't think those four beasts got along. I think if you put those four beasts together, they'd probably destroy each other. It says in Galatians, I think it's chapter 5, beware if you're going to bite and devour one another, that you don't destroy each other because you're acting like beasts instead of lambs, because you're walking in the flesh instead of the spirit. So if you're going to stay in the flesh, be careful that you beasts don't eat one another for lunch. It's just my quote of Paul. It's probably wrong, but it's just a feel I got from those verses. So you put those four beasts in Daniel's dream together, they're probably going to devour each other. But listen, these living creatures that have been beholding the Lamb for so long that used to be beasts, their wings are, they're covering each other. In the middle of them, and you see this in the book of Revelation more definedly, is the Lamb on his throne. So what do they all four see? The Lamb? What do they all four do? Cover the Lamb and one another? How do they all four move in love? My God, I can't get along with this person. We bite and devour each other every time we're together. Praise the Lord. Maybe God put you with that person specifically so the wind could blow and the beast could rise. What's supposed to be the end of your relationship with that person? That I never see them again and I move as far away from them as I can. Because when I'm with them, my beast rises. And when my beast rises, I feel like I'm not spiritual. And when I don't feel spiritual, I feel like God hates me and I don't like to be hated by God. So I'm going to go far, far away. Or God can pick that person to be your roommate or your husband or your wife, or I don't know, your child, I don't know, your boss, I don't know. But that person, and yeah, anyone that you're close enough to actually get real about your reactions instead of faking your way through the day, because we can, with someone we don't have much contact with, we can just do, oh, you're fine. You gotta live with them, beast will rise, right? Okay, unless it's Christ, and then Christ will rise. So maybe God blesses you with one of those beasts that when the wind blows, things rise, and you're confronted with, ooh, the Lamb has taken the throne. What is that meant to do? Man, that's meant to say, I gotta put my eyes on Jesus. I have to see the Lamb. I can't afford to look anywhere else. I have to stay fixed on him. I am gonna press in like I never did before. I'm gonna worship him for who he is and see that if without him, you know what I'm saying? It pushes you. You keep beholding. You keep letting the Spirit reveal that nature in you and show you who you really are in Christ. Let that Spirit flow into you through oneness. And all of a sudden, you begin to be lifted up. Lifted up with what? Wings full of eyes. And all of a sudden, those wings full of eyes start having this burning altar in the middle of them. There's fire. Let's let the cross take that beast out of us. Let's do it together. Let's pray together. Let's come together in the name of the Lamb of God who is our head and our fullness. And let's let the fire consume. Let the flame even devour the body of that beast. And let's let the Lamb take his throne on this altar instead. And let's carry that living flame with us everywhere we go. And let's our wings now unite instead of devouring one another. And let's come together in his Spirit and carry his throne as one body. And manifest the kingdom that we didn't manifest back in Jerusalem before in a living way. These are our opportunities, but we run from them. When really God says, I sent my Spirit to stir all that up, to bring you into my kingdom, to work in you contrast, to draw you deeper, to allow my Spirit to just do things he never could have done otherwise. You would have thought you were okay. You would have thought you didn't need it. But I want you to get my son in a real way. I want you to really get him. I want you to get him all the way. And so I'm going to allow the wind to blow, and I'm going to allow the beasts to fight until they can together fix their eyes on Jesus and let the Spirit begin to bring forth a new life, Christ as life. For this Lamb begin take his throne, new motives and intents coming forth until there's just a whole new gathering around the throne of the Lamb. That's when you go to Revelation chapter 4 and you see, let's go there, chapter 4, verse 6. And we have to end because we're already over. Hallelujah. Chapter 4 and verse 6. Revelation. No, that's fine. I was mumbling Revelation chapter 4, verse 6. So we've got this view now in the spirit of heaven, of the throne room, and it says here, and before the throne of the Lamb, there was a sea of glass like crystal, and in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind, and it continues to describe these living creatures. Each one has six wings. They're full of eyes within. They rest not night and day, saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. They worship him who is on the throne forever and ever. These converted beasts, these living creatures, all they do is worship the Lamb. And all they see is the Lamb on his throne, the slaughtered Lamb on his throne. That's all they do. That's all they see. They have given themselves to beholding the Lamb instead of what they are separate from him. And as a result of it, they are changed from glory to glory into that same image. As a result of it, they're closer to him than even the crowned elders were in that verse and chapter. They did it. They doggone it. They turned their heart to the Lord. They let the Spirit do what he does and just show us Jesus. They let the result of that be that we're changed. Hallelujah. For I know my thoughts towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to bring you to an expected end. Jeremiah's letter to the first group sent captive to Babylon. I'm working all these things together for this good. My heart is with you. My plan and purpose has not changed. There are glorious and eternal things going on in our lives. Listen, in the worst of days, in our worst failure, in the dark night of our soul, when we blow the chilly and the exceedingly dreadful beast rises from our sea, God is still God. The Most High is still there. He's still fathering our spirit, and he is using that to do one of the most wonderful things in our lives that could ever happen, that is bring forth his son in a governmental way. So if we can just be with him in the process and let the scriptures comfort us and guide us, you know, what can God not do in us to bring forth his son? Seriously. You know, you may be thinking, and we'll end here, why am I in this situation? This is awful. Maybe it's time for us to have a new faith. Maybe it's time for us to see things. You know, God gave them those eyes. Those are lamb's eyes that they have all over their wings and their wheels and their legs. And these are lamb's eyes. And maybe we need to say to God and to our Father, to Jesus, our head and our life, I need some eyes, Jesus. I need to see this situation different. I've been looking at it from the point of view of condemnation. I've been looking at the situation identified with the beasts. I have been looking at the situation from a place of being overwhelmed and depressed by my weakness and lack. I've been looking at it as if you're mad at me. I've been looking at it as if it's a sign that you've rejected me. I haven't been seeing it from your heart and how you've been using it to draw me up and in. I want more eyes. I need to keep with you until I'm full of your eyes. And things that I would normally look at and get depressed or upset or run from or hide or, you know, feel like there's no hope in this relationship or how could we ever, all of a sudden I go, wow, right there Jesus is coming forth. And that foolish, despised little mess called my life, the Lamb of God is going to come out of that. Because I'm going to keep beholding him and identifying there in a way beyond doctrine. My Lord, I mean, it's from the Nazareths. It's from the Bethlehems. It's from the Rahabs and the Tamars that we find the genealogy of Jesus Christ. It's from people who love Jesus enough to keep looking at him despite it all, that brought forth the Son. Be his Bethlehem. Be his Nazareth. Be his vessel in the process. And when the depths of the sea still contain things that aren't him, be his eyes. behold, be won, be overcome, be caught, be taken, taken with him and not your lack. You know, to those who love him. He's easy to love. He's easy to love. We do love him. And this is part of it. It's not a work. It's not a work of the flesh. It's a work of the Spirit and our heart's response to that. So may we respond, Lord. We continue to, you know, Lord, you know the deep struggles. Father, when people get caught in this process, it's a deep, deep thing. There are sea creatures that lurk in those depths that try to take us down. There are things that move to destroy and devour in a way that is not the work of the Spirit. But yet, Lord, your Spirit guides us, even as it guided Jonah in the belly of a whale and said, lift up your eyes and pray towards the temple. You may see this as the belly of the whale, but you are one with the risen sun, and you can identify there even when seaweed is wrapped around your head. Lord, thank you. Thank you that nothing shall separate us from the love of God in Christ. And Lord, that's true when beasts are rising from our sea and we need the Lord to be formed in us. It's also true when beasts are devouring us because the Lamb is formed in us. We just want to be with you, Jesus. We love you. You're the love of our life. You are our life. We don't want anything short of everything you have for us. Please, Father, keep us from running away from the very things you're using to bring forth your Son. We don't want to miss opportunities, but we do. We all do. Thank you for bringing them back around in their season, because we do want you as much as we can. Thank you for your mercy, your love, your long-suffering, your patience. Thank you for being the best Father ever. We love you and we give our hearts to you and ask that you would continue to help make these things real in us. Open your word, Lord. Bless your saints. In Jesus' name, amen.